हेलो फ्रेंड्स, कैसे हैं आप लोग। देखिए, लास्ट वीडियो के बाद कुछ नए फीडबैक मेरे पास आए। कई लोगों ने मेरे को एक चीज़ बोली है। उन्होंने बोला है कि मैं जो अपने लेक्चर्स है उसमें बहुत ज़्यादा ना हिंदी का यूज़ कर रहा हूँ और बहुत ही नॉर्मल लेमन लैंग्वेज यूज़ कर रहा हूँ, जिससे क्या हो रहा है, दे फील दैट कि लेक्चर्स उनको बहुत ज़्यादा फॉर्मलाइज नहीं लग रहे हैं। तो आज से मैं क्या करने वाला हूँ कि आज से मैं अपने लेक्चर्स ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा इंग्लिश में देने की कोशिश करूंगा, और जब बहुत ज़्यादा टिपिकल कोई कॉन्सेप्ट आएंगे तो फिर मैं हिंदी का इस्तेमाल करूंगा और आपको उसे हिंदी और इंग्लिश दोनों में एक्सप्लेन करूंगा। चलो, लेट्स स्टार्ट विद आर लेक्चर 10। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट आर्टिकल 19 ऑफ आर इंडियन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन। सो द थिंग इज दैट आर्टिकल 19 इज क्वाइट बिग, सो इट हैज़ 5-6 सब क्लॉसेस, सब आर्टिकल्स। सो व्हाट आई एम गोइंग टू डू दिस पर्टिकुलर लेक्चर आई एम गोइंग टू डिवोट टू आर्टिकल 19(1)(a), दिस डील्स विद राइट टू एक्सप्रेशन। सो दिस आर्टिकल दिस एंटायर लेक्चर विल बी डिवोटेड टू दिस ओनली, एंड फ्यूचर पार्ट टू एंड पार्ट थ्री ऑफ आर्टिकल 19 लेक्चर्स विल डील विद रेस्ट ऑफ द लॉ ऑन दिस थिंग। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद टूडेज लेक्चर। सो एज वी नो, दिस इज़ आर लेक्चर 10, एंड इन आर लास्ट लेक्चर वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट आर्टिकल 17 एंड 18। आई होप यू अंडरस्टूड दैट दोज कॉन्सेप्ट, एंड इफ यू हैव एनी क्वेरी अबाउट रिगार्डिंग दैम यू कैन आस्क दैम। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद आर लेक्चर। सो आर्टिकल 19, सो आर्टिकल फ्रॉम आर्टिकल 19 अप टिल आर्टिकल 22 डील्स विद राइट टू फ्रीडम। एज वी डिस्कस्ड अर्लियर दैट आर्टिकल 14 to 18, they were dealing with the equality principle of our constitution. These five articles, article 14 to 18, were devoted to equality principle. And from article 19 to 22, these five articles are devoted to the principle of freedom. So all these articles, article 19, 20, 21, and 22, deal with particular aspects of this right to freedom point. So the first article in this subpart will be article 19. Then first sub article of this article 19 deals with freedom of speech and expression. So we'll give a normal reading to our article first. Article 19, sub article 1. All citizens shall have the right A to freedom of speech and expression. See, it looks so simple, but it is not. How? The first thing we need to notice in this article is the term citizen. As we have discussed earlier, there are some fundamental rights which are available to both citizens and non-citizens. For example, Article 14. And there are some articles which are available only to cities. So this Article 19 is one of those articles which is available only to citizens. So all citizens shall have, okay? It is bound on the state to provide these freedoms. Shall have the right to, what right they have? Freedom of speech and expressions. See, for our human existence, this right is considered to be one of the basic things which all human beings require. What makes human beings different from other creatures is this right. Like, individuals, human beings have this utter desire to hold opinion and put forward them. So this is considered to be one of the essentials for human existence. So the first right that Article 19 provides is freedom of speech and expression. So this speech and expression is not only a right to hold an opinion, like if you have a particular opinion about something, it's just not restricting you to that, but it also grants you the right to express it, to propagate it, to tell it to other people that I hold this opinion, and if you believe in it, you can follow this also. So this is called propagation. One thing is to hold it in your mind, in your heart, and the other thing is to express it, that you tell other people that this is my opinion. And the third thing is to propagate it. Propagate it means that you tell other people that this is my opinion, and if you like it, you can follow. This is a propagation of your thoughts and expressions. So this is our Article 19(1)(a), right to freedom of speech and expression. But see, no right is absolute. Okay, it is necessary that there is a balance between the right that are provided to the individuals and the state, that state power to control these rights. Otherwise, it will be all mess. The reason being that if citizens or any particular individual is granted absolute right to freedom of speech and expression, it may lead to very different consequences in comparison to what was intended by our constitutional makers. So we need to take consideration of this fact. Okay, they can if this right is absolute, that what will happen? The people will be saying anything about anyone. So they in themselves there will be clash, because everyone will say that I have to hold this opinion to say whatever I want, but it may hurt others' feeling also. No, so there has to be a balance. So to maintain a society, to maintain that circle, so there are restrictions on this article also. And the restrictions for this subclause 8 to freedom of speech and expression have been provided by subarticle 2 of article 19. Okay, what did the subarticle 2 says? See, nothing in subarticle 1 point A shall affect, that is right to freedom of speech and expression, shall affect the operation of any existing law or prevent the state from making any law insofar as such law imposes reasonable restrictions on the exercise of the right in the interest of sovereignty and integrity of India, security of the state, friendly relation with foreign state, public order, decency or morality, contempt of court, defamation or incitement to an offense. Okay, we'll break this subarticle. No? The first thing is that in subarticle 1 point A shall not affect the operation of any existing law, which means that when constitution is being adopted, if there is a law which provides restrictions on freedom of speech and expression, it will not affect that law. Okay, and if there is no such act, and if the parliament in future wants to bring forth a legislation to control this right of freedom of speech and expression, it will also not affect that law also. Insofar as such law, that law which is existing or that law which is going to be adopted in future, such law imposes reasonable restriction. Okay, so this is important. This is the most important term of this subarticle 2, reasonable restriction, which means it means that the restrictions that can be imposed by that existing law or that will going to be imposed by a future law has to be reasonable. And what is reasonable, we'll see in future. Okay, but that restriction has to be reasonable on the exercise of the right in the interest of. Okay, the first thing to be considered is that the restriction has to be reasonable. And the second most important thing is that restriction has to be based on these grounds only. Okay, first it has to be reasonable, and second it must be based on any of these or one or more of these specified grounds. What are these grounds? The first ground is sovereignty and integrity of India. Okay, what is sovereignty and integrity of India? If a particular person is saying something or propagating something which threatens the independence of the country, the integrity of the country, it tries to break off people. Okay, communal violence and all is going to incite these feelings among public. So on this ground, sovereignty and integrity of India, a state may impose reasonable restriction. The second ground is security of the state. Okay, if a particular speech is going to threaten security of the state, security of the country, or security of a particular part of the country, it may impose reasonable restriction. Third important point is, third ground is friendly relation with foreign state. If a particular speech is going to threaten good relation with a foreign country, the state may impose reasonable restriction on this ground. Fourth is public order. If a particular speech is going to affect public order or peace in the society, the state may impose reasonable restriction. Okay, the next round is decency or morality. If a particular speech is going to like affect the decency which is being maintained in a society or the morality of the society, so the state may impose reasonable restriction on that this ground also. And if a particular speech is going to occur in contempt of court, is going to result in contempt of court, the state may impose reasonable restriction. If a particular speech is going to result in a defamation of a particular person or a particular company or a particular group, the state may impose reasonable restriction. Or if a particular speech is going to result in incitement to an offense, suppose if a speech is of such a nature which incites people to commit a particular offense, so the state may impose reasonable restriction on that ground also. So these are the grounds only on which the state may impose restriction that has to be reasonable. Okay, so what we have learned till now, the first thing is all citizens shall have the right to freedom of speech and expression. That means that all citizens of India have the right to freedom of speech and expression. Okay, and what are the restrictions? It is not absolute right, and the restrictions are that the state may impose if it wants through existing law, or it may adopt a future law also. It may impose reasonable restrictions on these grounds, which we just discussed. Okay, this is our Article 19(1)(a). Now we will move forward to the relevant case laws on this particular provision only. Okay, so the first case, not the first case. So what I have done is I have divided the all the issues into parts, which are coming out of Article 19(1). On each issue, I have discussed few cases. So I have divided this part, like the first is freedom of press, the issue of freedom of press. Okay. The first question after coming into the Constitution, the first question that was related to Article 19(1)(a) that arose was whether this Article 19(1)(a), that is the right to freedom of speech and expression, includes freedom of press also. One thing we must note that most of the constitutions around the world have a separate provision for press independence or freedom of press. But in India, if we read the Constitution, there is no mention of press. Okay, so the questions were arising during the debate and discussions also of Constituent Assembly while the Constitution was being discussed or drafted. So this question was put to B.R. Ambedkar also. Why there is no separate provision for press? Will press be going to have freedom in our country or not? So what B.R. Ambedkar said that there is no need for a separate provision for independence of press. It falls under Article 19(1)(a) because what Article 19(1)(a) says that everyone, whatever be the nature of that particular person, whatever be the profession of that person, as long as he is a citizen, he has a right to freedom of speech and expression. So all the press people will automatically fall under that criteria. So there is no need to provide separate law for that. So what we understood by this is that freedom of press is included within this provision. So the first important case which we are going to discuss as far as freedom of press is concerned is very popular, very important case, Bennett Coleman and Company versus Union of India. This is a case of 1973. The first thing in this case, the Supreme Court again reiterated that freedom of press is included within Article 19(1)(a). Then what happened? What are the facts of the case? The facts were the government of India passed a newsprint control order, 1962. The first thing we should notice is that this newsprint thing, it is a commodity which comes under the essential commodity, which falls under the Essential Commodities Act. So if a particular commodity, if a particular thing falls under Essential Commodity Act, the state has, the government has very broad powers to control its demand, supply, control its price and availability and all. So what government did, that as newsprint was falling under the category of essential commodities, it limited its supply to the presses, okay, the press companies who were into the business of newspapers. So, and it also framed some rules and guidelines under which what was said that the maximum pages which a particular newspaper could publish was limited to 10. Whatever be the size of the particular company in the business, whatever be the amount of information that it is giving, whatever be the size of its employment, doesn't matter. The maximum limit of pages that a particular paper could publish was 10. And what was the justification that government was giving was, the first thing was that newsprint is a particular commodity which is not easily available. So we have to manage its availability to all. The second thing was, through such policy, the government was trying to support small companies who were into this business, because it was providing them equal opportunity to get their hands to newsprint and publish their papers. And the third argument that the government made was that large part of newspapers of these big companies are devoted to advertisements. So they are not, they're wasting the this essential commodity. They are doing their own business. Okay. So these were the three arguments put forward by the government. So in response to these arguments, what the Supreme Court held was that the first thing was, this rule of limiting the maximum pages to 10 was unconstitutional. Why it was unconstitutional? Because you are not making a reasonable classification. Why? Because there is a particular company which is huge employment, which has huge circulation in the all over the country. And then there is a company which is small, which has limited assets, which has a limited circulation, limited to a particular city or a state. How can you compare these two? How can you make a singular law imposing similar limit to both of them? It has so many people to support, and it has so less circulation and so less people to support. How you can provide a singular rule of 10 pages to all? So it was grossly against these big companies. So the equality provision, Article 14, okay? Go back to Article 14, reasonable classification, intelligible differentia was missing. The second point the court made was that advertisements are very essential for any particular company which is into this business, because advertisements are their main source of income. The reason being that the price of newspapers is very less. The main essential component of their income comes from these advertisements. And if we reduce these advertisements, what will happen? That the price of newspaper will go up, because no company is going to survive otherwise. So, and if the price of the newspapers go up, it will not be like many people will be deprived of the information, essential information for their day-to-day life. Many people will not be able to afford the newspaper, because maximum population, Indian population, is still poor. So it will reduce the availability of information. Okay. Which falls under Article 19(1)A. Okay, right to information also comes under Article 19(1)A. So it will again violate Article the freedom principle, freedom of information principle. Okay. So this advertisement thing was also struck down by, the argument was struck down by the Supreme Court again. So what Supreme Court finally held was, this newsprint control order was violative of Article 19(1)A and Article 40. And government had no power to impose such restrictions on the newspaper companies. One more thing that Supreme Court observed was, the reason for the ground for restriction was that the commodity was essential. Okay, but there was no mention of, like, you are restricting a right to freedom of speech and expression of these media houses. What Article 19(2) says that you can impose reasonable restriction, and there are specified grounds, but you are not mentioning on which particular ground out of these you are making your law. Is this your rules, your press control order, newsprint control order, is falling under any of these grounds? Is it coming under sovereignty or integrity, security of state or friendly relation, public order, decency or morality, contempt, defamation, no. So how can you impose such a restriction on these business houses if this is it is not based on any of these grounds. And as it is not based on any of these grounds, it is violative of Article 19(1)(a). So this was Bennett Coleman case. The second important case was Brij Bhushan versus State of Delhi. This is a case of 1950. It came before Bennett Coleman, but it was concerned with very small issue of pre-censorship. What is pre-censorship? What is censorship? Censorship is a device or a tool at the hands of governments through which they try to control the information that is being circulated in the society. Okay, so what they do, like if there is such a particular such information or such an opinion which can go against a particular interest of a society, the government has the power to censor that information in order to maintain peace and tranquility in the society. Okay, so censorship is fine. No one is going against the censorship principle because it serves very important function in the society. But the question was pre-censorship. Okay, in this case, an authority has made an order that whatever journals a particular media agency is going to publish in future, first they will send their copy to that authority, who will see that if a particular information is okay to be circulated in the society, and if not, they will remove that part. Okay, so this was pre-censorship. So in this case, Supreme Court held that this pre-censorship requirement of this authority was not constitutional. Okay, because it may amount to severe restriction of right to speech and expression. Because even if a particular thing is mildly against like sensibilities, social or economical sensibilities of a particular community, you will remove it. So the freedom of speech and expression of that media agency, of those persons or who are the writers of those articles, will be severely limited. So the purpose of Article 19(1) will be doomed. So this pre-censorship thing was not allowed, and the Supreme Court further observed that if a particular journal contains such information and it is circulated in the society, then a review comes from the society itself that it is such and such which should not be allowed, then you can go and censorship them. But you cannot make a requirement that copy before publication you should submit a copy and then we will see if it is okay or not. So pre-censorship concept, as far as newspaper and journals were concerned, was struck down in this case, in the case of Brij Bhushan versus State of Delhi. Okay, the next important case. Okay, what are we are I'm going to do, I'm going to switch off this video and I will make another video so that the size of the video is still limited to 20-25 minutes. Okay, I'll see you in the next video, and we'll continue with our discussion.